Hello and welcome to another episode of Talking Politics here at The Hindu with me, Nistula, Hebbar, where we unpack the news, making the headlines in domestic politics. We were on a bit of a break last week, but not so Indian politics. There was a lot that happened, what with Sachin Pilot in Rajasthan raising the banner of revolt against his own party's government in the state, almost daring the Congress party to sack him. And the BJP's first and second list of candidates for the Karnataka Assembly polls led to rebellions and tears among the candidates who didn't get tickets. There was also a milk war that broke out between the states of Gujarat and Karnataka when the Gujarat milk cooperative company wanted to sell curd and other milk products online in Karnataka, and which has its own very strong milk brand called Nandini, a state-sponsored brand called Nandini, and there was a lot of milk nativism that went on all of last week. But we are, of course, not going to go into all of that. This week, we also saw the first steps of yet another attempt, yes, once more with feeling, to build a united opposition ahead of the 2024 Lok Sabha polls to take on a very, very dominating Bharatiya Janata Party. Now, on Wednesday, Bihar Chief Minister Nitish Kumar and his deputy, Rashtriya Janata Dal leader, Tejashwi Yadav, met with Congress President Mallikarjun Kharge and former Congress Chief Rahul Gandhi. He followed this up with meetings with Delhi Chief Minister Arvind Kejriwal, CPIM Sita Ram Yechuri, CPI's D. Raja, and possible meetings with NCP Chief Sharad Pawar, and plans to meet Telangana Chief Minister K. Chandrasekhar Rao and West Bengal Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee. Rahul Gandhi, in a tweet, called the meeting a historic first step, and I quote, "to stand together and fight together for the sake of the country." Now, the opposition, as you know, has been talking about basically what they see as a diminishing of democratic institutions in the country, a very, very hegemonic government, which is trying to get its own way in many things, and of course, a large number of opposition parties and leaders under the lens of investigative agencies in charges of corruption and otherwise. Well, there have been earlier attempts also to forge a united oppositional front against the Narendra Modi-led BJP. This was notably after the Congress JDS government was formed in Karnataka in 2018 with H.D. Kumaraswamy as Chief Minister. Y'all will all remember that photo op that happened in Bengaluru during Mr. Kumaraswamy's swearing in 2018, all opposition party leaders together with their hands up, etc. But in the run-up to the 2019 polls, the general elections of 2019, nothing much came of it. Now, regional kshatraps like West Bengal Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee and K. Chandrasekhar Rao of Telangana have also tried to forge a third front with Ms. Banerjee, trying to fight elections in Goa and Meghalaya with mixed success, and also reaching out to Odisha Chief Minister and Biju Janata Dal President Naveen Patnaik recently, and KCR, of course, having changed his own party's name from Telangana Rashtra Samiti to the Bharata Rashtra Samiti, basically indicating that he had some national ambitions of getting together non-BJP parties or parties opposed to the BJP on one platform. Well, but these are also, some of them are basically works in progress, and most of them have had very, very mixed results, leaning towards the negative side. So what happened in the Delhi meetings of Nitish Kumar, now that he is on the job, and what are the implications for both opposition unity and the state of Bihar as well? Well, sources have told The Hindu, there are some interesting pieces that my colleagues Sandeep Pookan and Shobhna Nair have written on this entire exercise. You may also want to go back to those pieces. Basically, that Nitish Kumar and Tejashwi Yadav spent over an hour and a half at Mr. Kharge's residence in the presence of Rahul Gandhi, focused on getting together as many parties as possible to work out a common political program. The series of meetings also comes amidst reports that Mr. Kumar, Nitish Kumar, who's putting in all this effort, could be made the convener of the United Progressive Alliance. It's a reworking of the old alliance that was in power for 10 years between 2004 to 2014. And that he would seek to reopen more parties in an effort to put joint candidates against the BJP in the Lok Sabha polls. This would depend very much on the comfort factor of the various opposition leaders, especially Mr. Sharad Pawar, who has also been coveting the convener's position in the UPA alliance. And Mr. Sharad Pawar, in fact, I think Congress was very much aware of this ambition. And Mr. Kharge met with Mr. Pawar. Mr. Pawar went to Mr. Kharge's house on Thursday evening and they had a bit of a meeting. Now, after Wednesday's meeting with Nitish Kumar, Mr. Kharge and him, they addressed a joint press conference at Mallikarjun Kharge's residence. And it was said that the opposition will work together to protect the constitution and democracy while giving a new direction to the country. Now, there has always been a feeling that there needs to be a positive agenda to take on Modi's BJP and the NDA, very formidable NDA alliance. And this seems to have multiple layers in terms of its strategy. So now I quote Nitish Kumar at this joint press conference. Now, this is what he said. He said, "Today we have had final discussions, and on that basis, we will move ahead and talk to others on the way forward. All those who agree will meet again." And he said that when we meet next, you will see a lot more people. So, battle is joined, the game is on, and Mr. Kumar has indicated that he would be doing a lot of traveling outside of Bihar subsequent to this meeting. Now, according to, again, sources and some briefings that opposition party leaders who were in those meetings, who met with Nitish Kumar, had with reporters of The Hindu, with my colleague Shobhna Nair, they said that opposition unity talks could run on three strands. One would be a common platform, basically not an alliance, but a common platform nationally for the 2024 general election. And at state levels, some coordination with regard to common issues that chief ministers of opposition-ruled states can take up, like federalism, cooperative federalism, the role of governors. There is this view that the governors basically take too much time. They sit on legislations passed by the state assemblies. They don't clear it because of some political issues. And all of those issues could be taken up by chief ministers of various opposition-ruled states and make that a common cause. And finally, and the most tricky part, to try and field a common candidate in as many seats as possible against the BJP. Now, there is no maths that we can depend on to know how many of these seats could possibly have a common candidate against a BJP candidate. Now, in many states, Congress and the regional parties are actually antagonistic. So that is also a very problematic thing. As I said, this was the most complicated part of this opposition unity exercise. Now, this is, of course, in many states, the vote catchment area of the Congress and regional parties, as I said, is overlapping. And they are, in fact, in direct competition, leading to fierce rivalries, like in Telangana, in West Bengal, in Delhi, and in Punjab. In many cases where a regional party or a party like the Aam Aadmi Party has entered the fray in various states, it has hurt the Congress or vice versa and helped BJP register big wins, actually, like in Goa and very, very recently, as we saw in Gujarat, where the Congress had a historically low tally of just 16 seats. It was almost wiped out. It was a debacle of mammoth proportions in the state assembly elections because the Aam Aadmi Party had entered the fray and won a few seats and cut into the Congress votes. Now, in such a scenario, which party, anxious to expand its footprint and support base, will decide to voluntarily hold back? Say that, okay, for the larger cause of opposition unity, my plan to go into X state will be put on hold. Now, the pull here will be between what the opposition parties, buffeted by a dominant BJP enforcement agencies and arrests, feels about an existential crisis. To fight alone, go for an expansion, but always have this fear that you are fighting it alone, or to pool strength and trust that support bases will not erode by this unity, that even if your voter is voting for a common opposition candidate, he will remain your voter once the need for such a unity is over. Now, responding to how many opposition parties were expected to come together, Rahul Gandhi said that it was a process and that the opposition's vision for the country was still developing, and all those parties that will be coming together will fight an ongoing ideological fight together and unitedly stand and take on the attack on institutions and the attack on the country. But more interestingly, such a plan would also result in a change of guard in Bihar, with Nitish Kumar making way for Tejashwi Yadav as chief minister. What will be the future of the Janata Dal U in that scenario, which is Mr. Nitish Kumar's party? Will others, and he is the dominant leader there, he is the only actually major leader acceptable to everybody in that party. Now, will others following former Union Minister Upendra Kushwaha leave the JDU, finding it diminished in clout, finding his own clout diminished within that scenario? You're dealing with Nitish Kumar, you have certain equations with him. Once he's out of the picture, RJD is the dominant party there. And you have leaders in the JDU who may not be able to take on the RJD and fight for their share of the pie. Now, will the RJD or the BJP cannibalize that party? Take away people, poach people to their side. Now, will the succession plan go through at all? These are all very, very tempting questions. Historically, this is not the first time that opposition parties have gotten together to challenge a hegemonic ruling party. In 1967, we had what we call the Samyukta Vidhayak Dal. Governments in various states under the leadership of Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia, he forged this opposition unity. He said wherever opposition parties have got seats, they all get together and challenge the Congress's numbers in those states. And there were several states in which the Samyukta Vidhayak Dal governments were formed. But as I have enumerated earlier, individual expansion plans and the need for unity are in a constant battle, and many a time coalition governments fall prey to that battle. In 1977, the Janata experiment was there against the emergency and the Congress party. That ended in 79. We had elections in 1980. Congress came back to power. In 1989, it was the National Front led by V.P. Singh, who became Prime Minister then, where the BJP and the left were propping up the government. In 1996 and 97, the short-lived Third Front governments of the United Front. In the very late 1990s, the NDA, with as many as 22 constituents, formed the government and ran it for 6 years, the first such coalition to complete a term. And that was also because the fulcrum of Indian politics changed from only Congress-centric to a bipolar one, where you had an NDA which was led by the BJP and other opposition parties which were opposed to the BJP and did not find Congress to be untouchable at all, as they did in the past. So therefore, we had 6 years of NDA rule, and then we had 10 years of UPA rule under the Congress and various socialist parties, etc. And now again, we are seeing like a fourth party system happening in India, where you had a Congress-centric party, then you had Samyukta Vidhayak Dal, and there were these, you know, regional parties against the Congress. Then you had the bipolar sort of a thing, and now you have the pole of politics changing again with the BJP at the center of Indian politics, as the fulcrum of Indian politics, where everything revolves around where you stand as per the BJP. So therefore, the things which appear cyclical, but this is the fourth party system in India, the challenges remain the same, and yet they vary. In all of these, the most important point would be whether the center of the alliance will hold. A central idea of common interests will be strong enough to transcend over individual interests of opposition parties. Now, stay tuned, for the going is bound to be bumpy. This is all I have for you this week. Thank you so much. for watching.